allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Byrne?
Here.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Here.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Here.
Mr. Nola?
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Here.
Mr. Ritter?
Here.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Here.
Mrs. Warning?
Here.
Mr. Warning.
Thank you, and I would like to announce that the board met in executive session for personnel matters on March 11th, 2016. We will begin this evening with a student presentation. Mr. Stalkoons?
Underwater robotics. We had teams that participated at the high school, and then we took the best team down to CMU. We have a short video presentation, and then Sam, Asher, Luke, and Mitch are going to talk a little bit about their experience with this competition and show you some of the different things that they did.
What is Sea Perch? Sea Perch is an innovative underwater robotics program that equips teachers and students with the resources they need to build an underwater remotely operated vehicle, or ROV.
Students build the ROV from a kit comprised of low-cost, easily accessible parts, following a curriculum that teaches engineering and science concepts with the marine engineering theme.
My name is Sam Mashenko. I'm a sophomore.
My name is Luke DePalma. I'm a sophomore as well.
My name's Asher. I'm a sophomore as well.
I'm Mitchell Wolforth. I'm a senior. And before you guys are wondering, like, hey, why Team Slambots? Because Sam, Luke, Asher, and Mitch.
Nice.
My dad just made the shirts, he knows who the race was for it, so
that was
pretty nice.
Good plug.
So we were given the opportunity to compete in this challenge provided through the Gateway Water Robotics program. This was about people's teams. And six teams, including the Robotics Club, all designed, created, and constructed a robot performed in this challenge. Originally at David High School, the only challenge we had was to navigate through the course rings. The original ring size that we were informed of at CMU was a 19-inch diameter, which we had to navigate through six rings as fast as we could, ascend to the top, descend, come back, and touch the wall in the quickest amount of time. The fastest robot was able to go to CMU.
Now, the time that we were able to achieve at Gateway was 1:07, but as the video was shown, we only got 1:32 at CMU. The reason for this was because we had to make modifications to the robot to be able to perform in the second challenge, which was, was the orb challenge. Now, what we had to do here was collect five balls from each of one of these contraptions and take them underwater to a submerged bucket and release them and have them float up to the top. And another one of the releases had golf balls. Do you have one? Just a normal golf ball you take out on the course, you know, play golf with. And what you had to do was stick it up the top, move the lever, and bring it back and release it down into the PVC pipe, dropping it down to the pool floor. What you had to do was push the ball up into a little crease, and you get points for that. And the other system was you'd place the ball underneath, and this ball would float up to the top. What you would do is use the same mechanism, push it forward and bring it back, and release the ball, and it would ascend to the top of the pool. And what we would do is come along and scoop it up with our robot. And then we would submerge it underwater and release it to the bucket, which allowed us to get points. And we were able to get first place in that challenge, and the second place team was far behind us, so no one was able to keep up with our design.
So at CMU, there were actually 16 teams that competed along with us, and as you can see by the scoring here, we did very well in all of the challenges that we had here. We got first in the orb challenge with 56 points, third in the poster and presentation, and third in the obstacle course, while Hopewell only got sixth in the orb challenge, second in the poster presentation, and first in the obstacle course. Now, we also had to design presentations, like you can see this one that we did here, and we had to present these to a panel of judges that graded us on neatness, correctness, engineering, and design principles that we showed off. So our robot went through an incredible amount of changes because, as you already know, the Gateway course only consisted of the ring shell and shover. We had to modify it to incorporate this, which was the orb challenge. And for the robot that we're hoping to take to Nationals, we've redesigned it, and we're in the process of completely changing the design to be much more efficient, faster, sleeker, and able to collect the balls much faster. So, yeah, that's pretty much what we did with Sea Perch.
Thank you very much, guys, and good luck in Nationals.
Thank you, Mr. Starkus.
Thank you.
All right. With that, we will go on to comments from residents on agenda items and agenda items only. Bonnie, do we have anyone sign up in advance?
No one signed up in advance, and I don't think anyone was signed up at this point.
Okay. Would anyone like to speak to agenda items? Seeing none, we will go on to section A, minutes of previous meetings. Bonnie?
Resolved the Gateway Board of School Directors approves the minutes of the following previously held meetings.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, motion passes. We'll move on to bills and financial reports. Mr. Schott.
Thank you, Mr. Student Board. Section B, resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors approves sections B1, list of bills, B2, monthly financial statements, and section B3 budget transfers as listed in section B at the Tuesday, March 15th, 2016 regular board meeting.
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion, there's a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Thank you, Mr. Schott. Section C, items previously tabled. We do have one. Mrs. Crump, would you like to speak to that?
This is concerning the AIU Smart Start program. Currently, we are recommending that we table this again for one more month. When I was at PASBO last week, we became aware of a couple of other companies that are creating programs to do the same thing, so we would like to be able to compare the cost and what they offer. One will actually do it in-house for us, and then we do emergency certs ourselves. So we'd like that opportunity to look at that before we make a decision.
Thank you very much.
Table.
It's already tabled, so we can just leave it tabled, correct?
Doesn't need to be?
It's already tabled. Yeah, we can just leave it tabled.
Okay.
Any questions or comments on that? Okay. Seeing none, we will move on to Section D, personnel. Mrs. Crump again.
Resolved that the Gateway School Board of School Directors accepts and approves the personnel agenda items 1 through 6 as listed in Section D for the regular voting meeting Tuesday, March 15, 2016. Under Section 1, we have leave of absence. There are 6 additional absences or leaves that have been approved, added to that since the last reading. Under transfers, there are 3 additional transfers that have been added since the last meeting. Employment, we have added 2 substitute teachers and 1 substitute teacher's aide. The next page, we've also added a substitute secretary to our list. Under Section 4, it's the approval of the employment contract of the business manager, Mr. Paul Schott. Section 5 are volunteers. We have also added 3 additional volunteers. And under 6, supplemental contracts, there have been additions made to that also since the last meeting.
Do we have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Motion second. Any questions or comments?
Quick question. Nobody conflicts with the anti-nepotism policy?
No.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye to all except for Michael Masterovich and Cindy Strotman, and I will abstain from the girls' head golf coach.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Aye.
Thank you, Bonnie. We'll move on to Section E, Administrative Resolutions. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbort. Under Administrative Resolutions, we have 14 items for approval tonight. Item number 1, overnight excursions. FBLA students will be going off to Hershey to compete in the annual FBLA competition. Item number 2, we have facility rentals for the mini-thon. We had students present last Monday at our study session to provide information on holding a mini-thon at the Gateway High School Sports Complex. Also, we have the Autism Society of Pittsburgh, South Indian dance performed by Gateway High School students looking at the auditorium. Item number 3, the AIU 3 program of services, the budget for the 2016-17 school year. Item number 4, educational services agreement for the 16-17 school year. Item number 5 and number 6, we do have Mr. Brown present today with the repair of the Gateway High School swimming pool unit and also the award of the bid in grass cutting and trimming. Also, we have a number of donations received by the district. Item number 8 would be the conferences and conventions. Mrs. Crump, the PASBA conference, and 2 teachers who are, one's going to the PA Speech, Language, and Hearing Convention. Another teacher, Holly Lewis, attending the Google Apps and Tools to Enhance Student Learning. We also have item number 9, the E-rate funding and network upgrade. We do have Mr. Brown available if there are any questions concerning that. Item number 10, Allegheny County Schools Health Insurance Consortium election. This item was discussed last week, and we will be asking for a vote on this exclusive of the other items that are listed. And we will get to that in a minute. Item number 11, payment to the Allegheny County Schools Health Insurance Consortium to obtain required health insurance data for strategic employee benefit services to obtain alternative health insurance quotes for the district. Number 12, authorizing ABM to complete a feasibility study of the district's facilities for a potential Act 39 of 2010 project, formerly Act 77, and we had a presentation last week by ABM. Also, the school calendar revision, and this is a note that this was added after the study session, Ramsey Makeup Day would now be Tuesday, April 26th, 2016, and that was due to the electrical issues at Ramsey Elementary. And the final number 14 would be the student teacher intern. We have cooperative agreements. We have a student from Duquesne University looking to perform some hours at Ramsey Elementary. And those are the items from the administrative resolutions.
Thank you. Do we have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Motion second. Any questions or comments?
I have a question. Conferences and conventions. Under Patricia Crump, February 24th to 25th. Are those the right dates or are they wrong? Don't we usually approve?
That was after the board meeting.
Mm-hmm. Right. We talked about it because she was going to present something for Mr. Rieger. And
okay.
So there's no cost for the conference. Is that accurate? Correct. Just for mileage.
I thought the dates were wrong.
Any other questions or comments?
I have a question on the E-rate funding and network. The amount estimated, is that, so we discussed this at the last budget meeting. Is this a lower number or the same number?
You were right, actually. I did have an incorrect amount in last meeting's agenda, but this is now below what was presented at the budget meeting.
So the minutes will reflect that Mr. Brown said I was right. I appreciate that. Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, I have a question. In the past, Mr. Short, have we made individual schools make up a missed day due to building problems?
To my recollection, we have not done that in the past. I do know the district has applied for a emergency day through PDE and has been approved.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
So we're going to make emergency day or we're going to make it up?
On the agenda it would be to make up the school day.
Do we want to have any discussion on that?
Sure.
Now's the time.
You go ahead.
I mean, Mr. Short, in your opinion, do you think it's prudent to bring out the buses for one school to make up their day?
I think there's a lot of factors that go into that, not only the buses, but also ensuring that we have the support staff available as well. And that would be a cost that would, of course, come from our district budget as well. So an opportunity for the kids to attend school. However, the rest of the buildings will not be present. So there will be an extra cost.
Do we know what the cost would be for the busing party? I believe you emailed it up.
I believe I gave an estimate previously, and it was about $2,600 for the buses for that day.
My 2 cents would be $2,600 is well worth giving the students the education. So everyone else was in class that day. I would think that we're here first and foremost to educate the students, but that's just my opinion.
Mr. Short, did you say you already applied for emergency?
No,
or you would have to apply?
We would have to apply for that.
Any other questions or comments?
No, I'm not sure how I feel about that. Just had some parent concerns. Just wanted to throw it out there in case anybody had some other additional comments or questions.
What were the parent concerns that raised to you?
That they didn't want the makeup day.
I think there's some factors with employment or other students in other schools. I can see both sides.
Question, does it come down that the teachers, staff, aides, whatever, did not get paid for that day for them not being there? Was the staff there? Or was the building completely closed?
The staff was present,
the teaching staff,
correct.
The teachers, the aides did, were not present, so they would be short one day of salary. So the teachers will be getting paid twice? For those that were attending?
No, that's an in-service day.
We put the in-service. So for the teachers, it's the same. But for the aides or anyone who worked hourly who was not there, they would not have the opportunity to make up that time.
So the only additional cost would be that roughly $2,000 to $3,000 for busing. Is that accurate?
Well, Mr. Short, do you know what in-service the teachers would be missing out on by having to teach? Was there a special training set for that day?
On the 26th, this is a district GEA in-service day. So currently right now, members of the GEA are submitting to Mr. Spinola information requests for what they would be doing during that half day of in-service. The second half of the day would be clerical.
And some of the teachers already completed the in-service that day, is that correct?
That is correct. I went over to Ramsey and held in-service professional development activity with the staff.
Do you know roughly what percentage of teachers attended that in-service?
I do not have the totals with me right now, but I would say pretty much the entire staff, maybe minus one or two.
Okay, teachers. So they would not be required to attend that 26th?
Not at all.
In-service, okay. Okay, any other questions or comments? Seeing none, can we have a roll call, Bonnie, all except for number 10, which we will vote separately on?
Yes. Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye, except for item number 3 and number 4. These are the AIU agreements, and I think most everybody here has heard my point of view on the intermediate unit, their cost structures, their contracts. So I'm going to vote no on that, aye on everything else.
Okay. Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye to all but 13.
Mrs. Cerucci?
I'm going to go with Stephanie on aye, but with the exception of the Ramsey makeup day.
And Mr. Lapsvich?
Aye.
Okay, thank you very much. And could we also have a roll call for number 10, please? Or not a roll call. We'll be voting on either number 1 or number 2. And was there a board member that spoke to one of these candidates last time?
I believe Val.
Number 2.
Val, did you speak?
On.
To number 2.
The Health Insurance Consortium election of nominee.
Oh.
You had made a recommendation.
Yes. I would suggest Michael Paradine, Ms. Allegheny.
Okay. With that, we will have a roll call, please.
Mrs. Byrne.
Number 2.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Number 2.
Mr. Lapsvich.
Number 2.
Mr. Nola.
Number 2.
Mr. O'Donnell.
2.
Mr. Ritter.
Number 2.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Number 2.
Mrs. Warning.
Number 2.
And Mr. Williams.
Number 2.
Thank you, Bonnie. Next, we'll move on to Section F, resolutions presented by board members. Mr. Ritter, please.
Sure, I'll read it out loud. And we brought this up last time, and so this is a quick overview. There's a 60th anniversary of the adoption of the national motto. The national motto is In God We Trust. And the resolution reads, the proposal reads, in the Gateway School Board, will investigate possible school district involvement with regional and national efforts to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the adoption of the national motto, quote, In God We Trust, unquote, period. So that's my resolution.
Okay. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call, Bonnie, please.
She's going.
Mr. O'Donnell?
Aye.
Mr. Ritter?
Aye.
Mr. Steubenbort?
Aye.
Mrs. Warning?
Aye.
Mr. Williams?
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne?
Aye.
Mrs. Cerucci?
Aye.
Mr. Lapsevich?
Aye.
Mr. Nola?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you very much. And do we have any other resolutions presented by board members this evening? Very well. Moving on to comments from residents on non-agenda items. Did we have anyone sign up in advance, Bonnie?
No one signed up in advance.
Okay, then we'll open the floor if we have any residents that would like to speak on any non-agenda items.
Okay, ma'am, you're coming closer to the microphone.
If you could please just sign in so it makes Bonnie's life a little easier, and then just state your name and address, please.
When you begin speaking, it's a condenser mic. It will sense the electricity is occurring, and it will kick on the second word that you speak.
Okay.
So just begin speaking.
Heather Bajay, 1332 Foxborough Drive, Monroeville. I was at the meeting two Fridays ago with the special board meeting, and I was wondering, were there any resolutions to the questions and comments that the residents had regarding the whole issue?
So I guess I'll address that. We had 45 individuals speak. I reached out to most of the individuals who we could receive that we had email addresses to. There are several that I will have to mail letters out to because we did not have any means of contact. As far as any resolutions, there are no resolutions presented at this evening's meeting.
So the question that was asked numerous times was who sent out the email? And do we have any answer to that yet?
That is currently a personnel issue that is under active investigation.
So is that why maybe Dr. Zetti's not here tonight?
I cannot speak to that. Mrs. Trump, are you able to speak to that?
Dr. Zetti has submitted documentation for the absence, which the board is we're waiting for all of that information. It's a personnel.
Okay, the second thing that I have, I don't know if I could have more than one thing at one time. I teach at Gateway Middle School, and one of the math teachers is on extended leave. And we've had different teachers covering throughout the day. The students are not getting a proper math education. Doug Zott was in there for a while and was pretty steady there, and was told that once he reaches the 20-day mark that we will put him somewhere else because we don't want to pay him the extra $10 for a long-term sub, is what the rumor is. So therefore, the students are getting a gym teacher, a social studies teacher, a science teacher in there every day, and is not getting a proper math education.
I can put that rumor to rest. That is an incorrect rumor. Mr. Zott was offered a position and he accepted a full-time position, which is why he got the position. We are very well aware that we need to have them looking everywhere.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Would anyone else like to address the board? Mr. Coulter, if you could please sign in.
Thank you. Actually, I did. No offense. Nameless, faceless.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm not going to curse the darkness here to light a candle. We had National Honor Society just about a week ago. Inducted 45 of the best and brightest juniors and seniors that the district had to offer. I think it's great that we do that. It's a great group of kids. Attendance was really low. When we talk about what are we holding out as role models in this district, these are the kids that have been singled out for academic excellence, leadership, character, scholarship out of the entire school body. And I may be missing some. I know Mr. Steubenport was able to come. Mr. Lapsevich, I know, was able to come. Some of you may have been there and I just missed you. But if there's anything we turn out for, wow, it would seem like it would be that. Is there any more pinnacle event, short of graduation? And even that's a little bit of a pat on the back when you get to graduation, not to denigrate it. But So to the extent that you guys weren't able to make it, I encourage you to think about what that stands for the district. Looking forward for opportunities to represent and really acknowledge those kind of performances, I would point out that the Gateway High School Musical on the town is coming up April 8th and 15th, the two weekends. Here again, we have a group of about 75 students. These are National Honor Society students. These are kids from the football team, the golf team. We got cheerleaders, we got band kids, we got the chorus kids. They all come together. They spend hundreds of hours putting together a professional quality production for the community. They don't do it for themselves, they do it for the community. And if we want to complain about things that are wrong in the community, well, let's be a part of the change and acknowledge the things that are going right. Go to the musical. That's the only way to show these kids, hey, we support what you do, is to show up. Buy a ticket. No offense if they offer you a freebie pass. Pay the $10. Because it's entirely self-supporting. This musical is put on with, no offense, no support from the school district. It's meant to be a self-sustaining enterprise. It doesn't make a profit, but they try like heck to break even. And ticket sales are a giant part of that. So if people want to say, hey, what's going on good in the community? Why do we only hear about bad stuff? This is something good. Avail yourself of the opportunity. It's a great story about sailors in the 1940s who have a one-day shore leave. If you haven't heard On the Town before, it's three sailors. They get to see New York City. They're looking for girls. They're looking for fun. They're looking for sights. But it's a family-friendly song, dance, music, acting extravaganza. So that's my plug. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Coulter. Would anyone else like to address the board this evening? Joe?
My name is Cheryl Boyce, and I live in Monroeville. I have a question about special ed. Last month when I was listening to the board meeting, and there are those of us that do watch it on TV, there was a discussion about autistic aides. Now, maybe I misunderstood what was said, but I have a family member who's now out of school, but who's special needs, so I'm very sensitive to the whole concept of special ed. The question was asked, are these aides receiving some preliminary training prior to going into those classrooms? And I got the impression the answer was no. Is that accurate? Are they receiving any kind? Because an autistic child, and there's a spectrum, we all know about the spectrum, you really need some kind of preliminary training. It's not something you walk into a classroom and all of a sudden you just do. You should have something initially. Now, it's an ongoing process as you're in the classroom over time working with the teacher, because the teacher knows those students best. But I was just curious, did I misunderstand that? Are we giving them preliminary training before they step foot, even in the middle of the school year when you're replacing an aide? Do we do that?
The teachers do.
So, but that's on the job training.
Been, right. Most of our aides have been with the district for quite some time. A lot of the new ones that we have hired recently are also people who have graduated with teaching degrees who are accepting positions as aides to get experience. So they have had that experience.
Well, I challenge that. Okay. Just because you got to have a degree, do we still have a licensed behavioral specialist in the district who is just focusing on those kind of things? Or is she back in the classroom? Is she back in the classroom? That's not acceptable either. Gateway, I don't know if it's a money decision, but a licensed behavioral specialist is, and I have one in my family, they are trained, they have advanced degrees, they have to take tests, and they receive either a state or a national license to be a licensed behavioral specialist. I don't care if somebody has a degree in education. I studied education. Most teachers, the average teacher, put in that kind of environment is not going to know what to do. But a licensed behavioral specialist who trains staff and aides, that's golden. And I don't know what the decision was, why our licensed behavioral specialist was put back in the classroom as a special ed teacher, but I would like to see her back where she belongs. And I think that training is important to every single teacher in the district, because behavior is everything in the classroom. And I think every teacher, regardless what their degree is, can benefit from a licensed behavioral specialist. So if it's a money thing, we need to address that. We need to really look at that. That is critical. And I don't think just putting on-the-job training aids in a classroom with a teacher, that's multitasking. And that's really tough when you have autistic kids. I know I talk a lot. Can I keep going?
We're going to keep it to the time limit. Sorry, Cheryl.
Then I'm going to talk to you individually because I have some other questions I want to ask you to. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Boyce. Would anyone else like to address the board?
Barbara Simons, Rabbi Temple David, the president of the Monroeville Interfaith Ministerium. I believe at a recent meeting, you were given the book or offered the book Nickel and Dimed by Barbara Ehrenreich. This is our initiative to be able to help us better understand what it means to struggle with poverty. So it's a community read. We're hoping to have many hundreds of people reading this book and coming together not only to discuss and raise awareness. Thank you. It is available at the public library at many of our houses of worship as well. You can also get it as an e-book and so forth. So I hope that you are able to read the book, and even if you are not, anyone is able to come to these conversations. I bring this up because I think especially with this conversation about Ramsey, one of the angles of not having school is that the kids who are on free and reduced lunch might not eat that day or might not eat enough. So as we think about educating the whole child, we need to think about that fact also. If we don't have school on a given day, those children might not be eating or might not be eating as nutritionally as they could have been. So as we think about the challenges that face our community, and unfortunately there are many, there are also ways that we can reach these challenges because we all have just so many resources and so many different kinds of connections. So I appreciate that school will be open for that reason, not looking at it so much from the budgetary position. I always believe we should educate our children as much as possible. But meanwhile, I do hope that you are able to read this book and engage in further conversation.
Thank you. And if you could please just sign in for us. Thank you, ma'am.
My name is Monica Richards of Garden City Drive. I was at the special staff meeting. I didn't get an email, didn't get a letter. I did speak. My concern is that there's no answers to the questions that many parents have regards to the situation. I'm assuming Mr. Short is there, so to me there was a resolve of this issue. My concern is, after that, we were on the news. Gabe was on the news again. Gabe's been on the news a lot lately, between what happened that Friday, Terry Smith, just a lot, besides what else is happening in Monroeville. I think the school board needs to find ways to work with the students and the teachers to embrace the diversities we have and kind of ways to get the kids to interact better. This here, you're going to be with us for 2 years, or say at Messier, I'm assuming. So I think it's time to get Gateway back into a brighter light, a school where people want to come back here. Not send their kids to cyber school, not move out of Monroeville. So that's just my opinion.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Before I start into what I was going to say, I want to congratulate the robotics team because that was pretty awesome.
You have to tell us your name.
And it was, I'm sorry?
You want to say your name.
Oh, sorry. It's Lee Sonatzer.
Okay, Lee.
Thank you. And number two is I totally forgot when I was here that I was in the musical and in one of the plays. So pretty great that we put the plug in there because it is pretty awesome. The kids put a lot of work into it. So unfortunately, I couldn't be here when you guys had the special meeting. And I heard a lot of rumors and a lot of questions. And I had a few questions of my own and some things I got from residents. Chad, I actually even tried calling you at the fire station, but they told me that you were allowed back in your house a few weeks ago. So I just figured I'd come here since you weren't living there anymore. Make this easy. So my first question is, what time did you know there was even a problem at the school, Chad?
No, there was a problem with?
The school. That there was a problem, that there was media here, that there was anything going on that Thursday. What time did you know? We found out at 4:30, but what time did you know?
We found out when we all got the email that you got.
Okay, so 4:30. Correct. All right. Did anyone on the board suggest having a meeting to discuss how, why the email was approved in the first place?
Yes.
I did.
Okay. You did? All right, then I guess the question is, why the board president and or vice president didn't call for an immediate meeting to discuss who and why the email was approved? Yep. When asked.
And I can easily address that. So we did have several board members request, you know, are we able to have a meeting? Should we have a meeting to discuss some of these issues? From there, I called our solicitor, Mr. Dice, and we discussed that there are protocols in place to follow in order to have a meeting. We could call for an executive session at any point in time. However, we can only talk about personnel issues. We could not vote on anything. We could not talk about anything outside of what is regarded as the Sunshine Law.
Well, was it not a personnel issue, the email itself? And
we could talk about personnel issues only.
So you could have talked about that?
We could have spoken to personnel issues
only. So it would have made sense to talk about it, correct? Because I guess my next question is, would any of you agree that you would have answers for residents and parents at an executive board meeting been held addressing the issues of the email and who approved it and who did not?
So just to answer, an executive session is a closed meeting. It is just the board. We would not be able to take any action at the meeting. We could only speak to personnel issues. I sent out an email to all board members explaining that and heard back from board members, well, if we can only speak to personnel issues, then it's not something we have to have an emergency meeting over.
And what Chad's trying to say in so many words is, if he wants to have a meeting with you, you have to advertise it under the Sunshine Law. That takes at least 24 hours. Do you remember when we had the meeting? We had the meeting Friday.
Correct.
As quickly as possible, they advertised to have the meeting, and that's what we did.
And
in his defense, so you're attacking him, but we did have an executive session Friday.
Well,
before that meeting, we did.
The problem I have with that is you had an executive meeting to discuss the personnel issue 24 hours after there was already a problem. And I guess I find that kind of odd when we know that the media was here and everything else was going on and all
that. Can I just say, because we talk to each other all the time. So for you to don't assume that because we don't have a public meeting that we're not communicating, because we communicated probably for 3 to 4 hours the night that email came out with one another. So I don't want you to think that we don't care about these issues or that we don't talk about them when we're not in a public setting. We communicate with each other quite frequently via phone and via email and via text.
Okay, well then my last question, and it'll be easy for you then, because my last question is, what was so important that you felt the police department needed notified, however decided that it wasn't important enough to hold a meeting that night to lead the district through a tumultuous time where administration made statements that could have come across as insensitive, and in fact many residents publicly stated that they did think it was insensitive in nature?
So the police was an action by high school administration. That was not a board-approved action to have police officers there. So I guess that will answer that.
I guess I'm just kind of curious how, as the board, I would think that you guys would be apprised of all that.
We were informed, and all board members were aware that there were police officers there.
Okay.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to address the board?
Different topic, so I took the coat off, so I look like a different person. Robotics Club, great congratulations for them on what they've achieved. I have a feeling they're probably going to need funding going down to the national championships that they're heading for. I noticed when I was enrolling my kids for the upcoming high school course selection, in the very front of the course guide is a list of our national merit finalists and semifinalists over the last 10 years, and we used to have them, and they went down and down and down. The last several years, we've had none. It's not that the education has gotten any worse. It's not that the teachers have gotten worse. Honestly, it's that some of the families that we had giving us national merit finalists are not here anymore. And those parents are looking for things like robotics programs and things like that. So if you have an opportunity to look for financial support, I think not only for these boys and what they've achieved, but I think that helps get the school moving in a direction that puts us in a positive light as compared to some of the other things we hear about. Thank you.
Before you start the timer, is there any chance of getting you to read your reply to my questions that I posed at that public meeting?
I can do that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So again, addressing the questions that were asked, so it starts with Rick. At Friday's special board meeting, we had 45 people speak to the board. As president of the board, I believe I should reach out and answer everyone who posed a question to the board. With that being said, I do not intend to debate any issues nor share any information that pertains to personnel issues, as there are laws that prohibit that. I will, however, try my best to answer your questions. You asked a lot of questions, so I'll try to address them all. Number one, why are we here? To give the public the whole story of what had happened. Up until our meeting on Friday, no one was given the whole story, and we felt that needed to change. Number two, who paid for the cops at the schools? The police were on-duty officers and detectives, so there was no charge to the district. What about the two that were at the meeting? The district paid for the two police officers at the meeting, similar to how we pay for police for sporting events. I'd requested we have police there due to seeing how bad some of the messages were on our Facebook and news's Facebook pages. We obviously want to be sure everyone is safe. Number four, why were board members told they were overreacting? Not sure I can answer that one for you. However, I do know you mentioned that I didn't want to call for a meeting Thursday night. That was not the case. I actually left the Pens game on Thursday after seeing just one goal due to me believing there was this was way more important. I did, however, reach out to everyone and got Bruce's opinion as well. We could not hold a meeting without advertising, and we could only discuss personnel issues in an executive meeting. So I asked all the board, and they said that it would be pointless to do that. While reading through the policies on Friday, I learned that we had a clause that we could hold a meeting without the 24 advertisement if we believe there to be an emergency where harm to person or property was possible, which is why I called for the meeting, even though some did not think this constitutes an emergency. Long answer, but hopefully that gives you some clarity. Number five, are we a political or educational institution? We're obviously an educational institution, and everyone agrees that the email was a mistake by administration. Now, with that being said, teachers, administrators, and the like cannot do anything political at school. However, the students have every right to do so. So even though you personally may not agree with Black Lives Matters, the students are free to wear them just as someone is able to wear a White Lives Matter shirt. Now, I obviously hope that neither of those shirts show up, as I believe as a community we are above that. Number six, mad about the time limit. As for the time limit, that is board policy for any agenda time in which more than five people speak about. As always, feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions in the future. Love me or hate me, I have no problem answering any questions where I can for any constituents, and believe we know each other well enough that you can just call. Thank you. You're welcome, Rick.
So, first of all, I was flattered and appeased and tickled that you actually took the time to write such a lengthy response, and then I started reading it.
You said the name, please.
Rick Atwood, Griffin Road. And as I continue to read, that elation turned into flat-out disgust, truth be told. Number three, the two that were at the meeting, okay, that's fine, I totally get that. You know, somebody decided that there should be somebody here to, you know, keep the parents quiet, much like shutting off the cameras and making it so the viewing public at home couldn't see it anymore, much like as you admitted that night where you had all Facebook posts and or threads deleted. If your statement where the kids have the freedom of speech and they can wear whatever they want is the truth, the parents, the taxpayers, the voters can certainly speak on Facebook threads on their school's page and air out their concerns while trying to determine what action is best for their children. For you to delete that stuff, for you to try to censor anybody in this room that has parents, has children in the district, this is almost a week old, I'm still having a hard time wrapping my mind around that one. Truth be told, where you discussed and you talk about, you called Mr. Dice and
I've known Mr. Dice for a long time. I know that he will fall on the sword faster than you can possibly imagine. For you to suggest that he did not know that there was an emergency rule about the person place, I'm not even going to ask. I'm sorry. I would have to guess that's not true. And I had a ton of other questions for Dr. Zetti, but I don't know, I guess she got the flu or something, or she realized the error in her judgment with this whole debacle that is going on. Mr. Short, I congratulate you. I wish you the best. I have a sneaky suspicion that you're going to be here for quite a while, and there's going to be a severance package getting paid shortly. Going back to this freedom of speech for the children, so by your statement and by signing it as president of the board, all of your statement.
No, I speak as one member of a nine-member board.
President of the school board.
That would be a title just like municipal worker.
We don't check each other's emails. He's free to respond to you as he so chooses.
Because you are not speaking on behalf of the whole municipality or the municipal works, I was not speaking on behalf of the whole school board.
My suggestion would be if you're just doing it as a board member, I would just sign school board. Because when you sign it as president, I'm thinking you're speaking for the whole group. But either way, that's neither here nor there. So if my kids decide that they want to bring it into school tomorrow and wear a, I don't know, what is the world find so totally appalling these days? A Confederate flag shirt, it's okay? A Ku Klux Klan something, it's okay?
No.
A swastika, it's
no.
Okay?
And
why not?
I would defer to Mr. Dice's.
No, if one hate group is acceptable, why is not the other?
Because there are court cases that decide those situations. If the shirt causes a disruption in the classroom, you can send the child home. But it has to cause a disruption. And some judge that's going to be sitting there outside Gateway, not looking at the people that are here, is going to make that decision. And if he decides, or she decides, that the shirt disrupted the classroom, causes that kind of disruption so that the teaching mode can't be achieved, then the shirt's going to be banned, he's going to get disciplined for that. If, however, it says support free speech or some other language on it, the judge is going to say that's an exercise of free speech. So it's a close call as to whether or not swastikas, you know, KKK, I'm going to kill you, things like that have been ruled upon. But there are situations that can be very close, and you have to balance the First Amendment, free speech, versus the disruption in the classroom. You know, it's very, very difficult for teachers today, hard enough, than to introduce these kinds of subjects. And here's the problem. We start talking about them, and kids get the idea to do it. And that I think we got to try to put this behind us a little bit. I mean, we're working on solutions here. Believe me, this board's working hard at it. And I would suggest to you that kind of shirt's not acceptable, but give us some time and get through this. And I think everyone will at least feel that the board has done its due diligence.
I appreciate the answer, Mr. Dice, and my only request would be then, while this is being reviewed and whether or not any shirt that promotes racism, promotes quasi-terrorism, I'm a big fan of Google. If you Google any of the instances that I just said, all four of them, every one of them is considered by many law enforcement agencies, terrorist groups, hate groups. I would think that if this officer's child was in a classroom and somebody rolled in here wearing a Black Lives Matter shirt, I would believe that his child would feel disrupted. His educational experience would probably be negatively impacted, as that group is an open proponent of murdering police officers.
Your time is up. Thank you, Mr. Atwood.
I do know.
Would anyone else like to address the board? Seeing none, we'll move on to board or administrative and board reports. We will start off with Mrs. Crump. Thank you, Mr. Schott.
Just one item, just a note, 259 days without a complete state budget. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Short.
We do have our monthly celebration of excellence. Mrs. Zanella, are you ready to cue that up on a PowerPoint?
Yes, I am, Mr. Short. Thank you. Okay, the following reflects the work of the staff and students of the Gateway School District during the month of March, who are blue ribbon bound under the area of leadership. Congratulations to two Gateway High School band students pictured because they have been selected to participate in the Bands of America Honors Band. The BOA Honors Band will participate in the 2017 Tournament of Roses Parade in Pasadena, California. Both girls submitted an audition tape and were selected from hundreds of applications from across the nation. They will participate in the BOA Honors Band with 300 other students selected to represent every state in the nation. Cassie and Naomi will travel to Pasadena shortly after Christmas 2016 and will rehearse for several days before their parade performance. They will also participate in the parade through Disneyland, visit several fantastic sightseeing spots in California, and conclude their trip with a performance in the Rose Parade. The Gateway High School Winter Color Guard was crowned WGI Pittsburgh Regional Class A Champion recently at the Winter Guard International Regional, which was held at Norwin High School. 21 schools competed in the Class A contest. The Gateway Color Guard finished first in the preliminary competition held during the day and was seated first going into the final contest. In the finals contest, the Guard performed absolutely stunning performance of their show, which had the crowd totally engaged. The performance was rewarded with a standing ovation from both the audience and several hundred fans and the 500 other students from the competing guard units. Congratulations, ladies, and Mr. Reed for making Gateway proud. Great job. The Ned Show made an appearance at Evergreen Elementary School. The Ned Show is a character-wide education program that centers on a 45-minute assembly called the Ned Show. Ned is a lovable cartoon character whose name is an acronym for N, never give up, E, encourage others, and D, do your best. Thanks to Evergreen for bringing the show to the school and helping our students to embrace these messages. On March 11th, Gateway Middle School students were rewarded for their positive and appropriate behavior throughout the school year with a Minute to Win It assembly. The wonderful staff at Gateway Middle School took the time to celebrate students with a fun afternoon assembly that fostered teamwork. The assembly was similar to the game Minute to Win It. Congratulations to Monet Finley and Peyton Otterman for submitting winning videos to the Southwest Pennsylvania Say No More Video Contest. Both Monet and Peyton worked on the contest as part of the broadcast journalism class here at Gateway High School. Monet received $500 cash for her first place winning video, Join Together and Say No More. And Peyton received $200 cash for her People's Choice winning video, Get the Facts. Kara Kern, a 2014 Gateway graduate and a student at the University of Pittsburgh Johnstown, spearheaded Easter for Eli together with Kristen Hewitt at Mossside Middle School. Easter for Eli collects items for Easter baskets that are delivered to children in local area hospitals. Eli Garrett is a 3-year-old boy who lost his battle with cancer in 2009. His family delivered over 1,000 baskets last year in his honor. The baskets were filled with items such as games, coloring books, puzzles, and other items. Thanks to Ms. Kern and Ms. Hewitt for working on this wonderful project. University Park Elementary School has been named one of the top 50 schools for homebuyers in Allegheny County. UP was ranked 39th by the Krivita School Source. Krivita has developed a custom algorithm that ranks and assigns most public schools in the United States its own unique Krivita School Source. Each score takes into account several factors to assist homebuyers in deciding where they should purchase a home. It includes home values, quality of schools, income levels, and more. Mr. Tully, Ms. Cheslock, and the Gateway Middle School staff honor two students once a month with the Student of the Month Award. Students are nominated by their teachers for displaying Gator pride which is defined through their display of respect, responsibility, and safe interactions with peers, staff, and administration within the school. These appropriate interactions assist with individual student academic progress as well as maintaining a healthy educational environment for all students. Each student who receives this honor receives a $10 gift card to GameStop, Target, Walmart. They get a t-shirt and are recognized on the morning announcements. The students listed on the screen have earned the honor so far this year. Recently, Mossside Middle School 5th and 6th grade students raised almost $1,500 for Pennies for Patients, which provides needed funding for leukemia for the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. Thanks to all the students, staff, and parents who saved their pennies to donate them for this worthy cause. In addition to the wonderful On the Town musical that is coming up, and that's in April, please mark your calendars and plan to attend the Senior Honor Concert on Sunday, May 15th at 2 p.m. This will be Bob Reed's final concert with the Gateway Band Program before he retires at the end of the year. This will be a wonderful show and a chance for the community to show Mr. Reed how much we're going to miss him at Gateway. The shining faces on the screen are part of University Park's Principal 200 Club, which is part of the school-wide behavior support program. When a student is recognized by a teacher for doing something positive, the teacher will write up a blue ticket and send it to the office. The office then writes the student's name on a white ticket and posts the 200 board names outside the office. Once the board is filled up, all the students are called down to the office and they receive a prize, and that's what you see them doing on the screen. Under the area of scholarship, Gateway High School honored 45 National Honor Society inductees listed on the screen during a candlelight ceremony last week. National Honor Society inductees maintain and encourage high standards of character, scholarship, leadership, and service. Congratulations to these fine young men and women who serve as role models for all Gateway students. Our educational partner, Forbes Road Career and Technical Center, also hosted the annual National Technical Honor Society ceremony and breakfast. 12 Gateway High School students who are listed on the screen and who attend Forbes Road were inducted into the National Technical Honor Society. Nick led the Pledge of Allegiance, while Montea and Jose presented the knowledge and fourth attribute. Congratulations to these students on such a wonderful and well-deserved honor. Congratulations to this year's AIM Academic Challenge teams for earning first and third place at the ESSPA Academic Challenge competition hosted by West Mifflin High School. 12 teams from around the region competed for the Academic Challenge plaque. The winners are pictured on the screen. This is the second year in a row that Gateway AIM students earned first place in this academic competition. The two Gateway High School students pictured earned second place on the Fairchild Challenge at FIPS Challenge Number 4 Project Design, Green Up Your School. After countless hours of research and design, the students submitted a detailed trifold display highlighting the use of bifolic design in their schools. They included four current environmental club projects, proposed projects that bring nature into the school setting. The students also had to prepare an action plan to green up their school. Gateway Middle School is happy to announce its Spotlight on Youth Night on March 16th, 2016, which is tomorrow night. Doors will open at 6:15 p.m. Guests are invited to view the student art gallery, Tastes and Treats made by the FAC students, and run a race on the CO2 car track. At 7 p.m., guests are invited to the auditorium for a free concert featuring some of the middle school's finest musicians. This is a wonderful evening to showcase our students' talent and ability, and we look forward to seeing everyone there. And congratulations to the team listed on the screen who represented Gateway High School at the Pittsburgh Regional Sea Perch Competition held at Carnegie Mellon University. Mitch, Sam, Asher, and Luke were here to give their demonstration tonight. They did an amazing job. We congratulate them on their exceptional efforts. The Pittsburgh Pirates presented a program at Evergreen Elementary School for the fourth grade students. The program highlighted the legacy of Negro League Baseball and accomplishments of the players who broke the color barrier. The program also encouraged students to write about their obstacles and successes. The Pirates also gave each student a copy of the book, We Are the Ship, which highlights the story of the Negro League Baseball. Thank you so much to the Pittsburgh Pirates head office for their generosity and for taking time to work with our students. The three AIM students shown on the screen competed in the World Affairs Council of Pittsburgh's Academic World Quest on February 23rd at Duquesne University. Over 40 schools competed for the grand prize of an all-expense-paid trip to the National Academic World Quest in Washington, D.C. later this spring. The Gateway High School team did a great job, but unfortunately did not earn the grand prize. The event was emceed by WTAE-TV's Mike Clark, who is also shown in the picture. Congratulations to the team for a fine effort. No, this isn't the Cat in the Hat. It's Dr. John Fournier, principal of University Park, preparing to read to his students to celebrate Read Across America Day. The day celebrates and encourages reading books so that reading becomes a lifelong practice. Congratulations to the Gateway High School team on the screen for earning second place in the Eastern Suburbs Special Program Association's Mr. President's competition. Joe Miller and Alan Kwong respectively earned second and third place individual awards. Mrs. Detman, autistic support teacher, and her students are working hard to prepare the greenhouse at Gateway Middle School's outdoor classroom. Ms. Detman and her students are revitalizing the outdoor classroom with seedlings that they are planting and growing in the classroom. During the spring and summer months, the students will utilize their skills learned in the class as well as teamwork to create a beautiful learning environment for all of the middle school students to enjoy. Both of Gateway's VEX robotics competition teams at Gateway High School participated in the Western PA State Championships Tournament on Saturday, March 5th. Team 9656B finished number 3 overall and was the captain of the number 2 seeded alliance. Team B lost in the state championship finals to a very strong alliance from Sidman, PA. Team A was also a quarterfinalist. Congratulations to both teams for a wonderful showing. And lastly, under the category of sportsmanship, we congratulate the talented group of high school swimmers and divers shown on the screen for earning a spot as WPIAL qualifiers. The Gateway Boys Swim Team placed 15th overall at the WPIAL Championship and second place in their section for the season. Unfortunately, no one qualified to move on to the state championships. Speaking of swimmers, the boys placed 8th in the 200 freestyle relay at the WPAL Swimming Championships at the University of Pittsburgh. The swimmers shown on the screen earned 8th place out of 26 places, earning them medals. Congratulations to all the swimmers and divers for a great season. And we have just a few reminders on the screen. Please mark your dates, your calendars for the following events. We have March 16th again, that's tomorrow night, for the Spotlight on Youth. That starts at 7 o'clock at Gateway Middle School. On the 17th, Forbes Road Career Technology Center is having an open house they'd like everybody to attend. There is a curriculum meeting at 6 p.m. March 17th. March 21st, Evergreen is having Muffins for Mom at 8:30 a.m. March 24th is the Snow Makeup Day for Gateway students, so they need to report to school that day. And of course, March 25th through the 28th is our spring break. March 29th is the end of the third 9 weeks already. March 30th is the Budget and Finance Committee meeting at 7 p.m. here at the high school in the LGI. April 5th, report cards will be available for your review on Skyward. April 5th is going to be a school board study session at 7, and April 19th, it will be our regular board meeting at 7 o'clock. Again, I'm going to remind everybody that on the town, there's information on the website that tells you about the box office times, ticket sale prices, and a little information about the play if you're not familiar with it. It's a fantastic play. The kids have been working really hard, and they really would like to see you out there in the audience cheering them on. So please go to the website and check out the box office times so you can purchase your tickets to attend the play. Mr. Short, that's all my report this evening.
Thank you, Mrs. Zanella.
Regular question.
Mr. Lapsovich.
Yes, Mrs. Zanella.
Yes.
The color guard, the one that the awards and stuff, when did that take place?
I'd have to look on when it was a few Saturdays ago. Does anybody know the exact date?
Okay, with all that good news we have up there, you know, with our kids and our faculty, was it brought to the taxpayer or the parents' attention that this is all going on at Gateway instead of some of the negativity? If this was brought out more, I think they would understand the great school that we have. Was that any of that brought out to the public?
Some of it was covered by the media. We send stuff out. They pick it up when they can on the run the stuff. But yeah, we do send the stuff out and tell the media. We invite them to come. They were invited to the Minute to win it and a number of different things. So, and they run the stuff as they can in the newspaper.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Clearly, you could see from the events that have happened this past month that we have highly artistic, intelligent, creative students who have, you know, achieved some wonderful things. So let's not forget, as Mr. Lapsevich said, what we are currently doing within our district with our children and what we will do as we move forward with our students in helping create a better environment, not only for communication, but instructional efforts as well. With that, I'd also like to remind everyone about a curriculum meeting on Thursday. It's important. I'd love to have everyone in the audience right here Thursday night at 6 o'clock. We will be reviewing curriculum changes to the instructional program. This is K through 12 in a number of different areas, including math, world language, STEAM, physical education. So please, everyone, you're invited to 6 o'clock on Thursday. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Short. We'll start with board reports. Scotty?
Nothing this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Ritter?
Sure. Seven things. Boy, can I be quicker. Okay, the first one was one of our tasks was to offer a letter of encouragement to the state representatives and state senators and the governor to resolve the budget impasse. We did send that letter out a few days ago encouraging them to do their job. Number two, there was a special board meeting. 41 questions and comments were collected, and a response was generated. Number three, the Allegheny County Legislative Forum on Education was held recently. That's on the 10th at the Allegheny Intermediate Unit facility in Homestead. John Delano was there, as well as some state senators and representative, Jay Costa, Hal English, etc. Comments from the audience when I was there were quite interesting. Folks from East Allegheny, Penn Hills, Aliquippa, Bell Vernon, Plum, Clareton stood up and said, the budget impasse that is your fault, and they were pointing to the members on the panel, is causing us to not be able to borrow more money. We're out of money. We can't borrow anymore. Our schools are about to close. You sent a letter out telling us the best way to close our school, the procedures on which to follow. And the level of tension in that room was very high because the legislators and the governor are at odds with the budget impasse. Some people wanting to bring the cost of education down, some people wanting to not cut programs. And so there's that tension. And I'm glad that we were able to send that letter out to recommend, to encourage them to find a way to resolve that. One of the best things that I heard from some of the members were, the legislators were saying, we now understand we must compromise. We just need to find a way to do it. So they're no longer denying the issue. They're trying to find a way to compromise. And the other one interesting comment was that the pension issue dwarfs all other issues. If that's not solved, it's like putting a Band-Aid on a sinking ship. So I was glad to hear that. Next, number four, the open house was just recently held at Forbes Road Technical Center down there. I was there for an hour and a half. What terrific work those folks are doing. Some of our students go down there, they take classes. Wonderful, wonderful. Number five, the Pennsylvania School Board Association's Advocacy Forum will be held in Harrisburg on April 4th. They've invited some of us to go out and participate and help advocate for some of the issues that are occurring here in the school district. I would love to try to go. I don't know whether I'll be able to do it. Number six, Pennsylvania School Board ESSA examination team, that's the Every Student Succeeds Act examination team, has been assembled. There are some experts from around the state. They are looking for input, so I toss the question to the board here. Can we package together some recommendations to this team, take it to them, and have them chew on some of the issues that we offer them? And lastly, number seven, I wanted to develop an objective means of evaluating the board's performance, and I wanted to report that I have failed to make progress identifying or creating an objective means of testing and measuring the board's performance. The thought behind this is everyone should have a means of measure of knowing what to do and then measuring whether you've done it, including the board themselves. When teachers go to school, they learn how to create tests and measurements. I'm wondering whether one exists for the board. I found one that loosely identifies the board's best goals, but not an objective means as to tell whether a given board is performing those duties successfully. So I failed to come up with a way to do that for us. And that's my report.
Thank you, Mr. Ritter. Mary Beth? Yes.
Okay. In response to some of the people here this evening who either didn't get an email communication from Chad or who didn't have their questions adequately answered or felt that they didn't have them adequately answered, I did compose a list of questions from to last Friday's meeting and some answers. So if you would bear with me for a few minutes, maybe this will help to answer some further questions for those of you who feel like they weren't quite addressed. And some of these are based on information that was read by us on social media that was inaccurate. So if you wonder why some of these statements I'm reading, why I'm saying them, that's because I saw them on social media and they're false and I want to set the record straight. Okay. No students were arrested for wearing Black Lives Matter t-shirts as stated on social media. No students were arrested at the school last week at all. No guns were brought to school. No students were expelled. However, some suspensions were issued as consequences of threats. One student was removed from the school for disorderly conduct. In regards to safety, there were no fights at the high school, and there were no verbal confrontations that occurred since that after-school fight Tuesday, March 2nd. In an attempt to make students feel safe due to the threats against some students, extra police security was in place at the school on Friday, uniformed and plain clothed. The additional level of coverage was continued on the subsequent Monday as a preventative measure. However, lack of incidents resulted in a lifting of the in-school coverage. At the request of some parents, several school board members, including myself, spent a significant amount of time at the school the following Monday, walking the hallways, observing the atmosphere, and meeting with the principals. No issues arose. The board members left with the utmost confidence in the job the principals were doing. The board investigated rumors that fights took place in the cafeteria on Friday. Those rumors were unfounded. No fights occurred. A few facts regarding discipline at Gateway. 85% of Gateway students have zero disciplinary infractions over their 4 years as students. 400 disciplinary actions have been issued this year, and 40 students committed half of those. The majority of disciplinary actions are for cutting class. Lastly, the school board has authorized school administrators to create and transmit communications, including email, as necessary. Prior review of email communications by the board would impede the ability of the administrators to perform their duties in an effectual and timely fashion. The school board best serves the administration and the community when it fulfills its limited role of providing oversight. Again, as I said to many people, I don't believe in commenting on these things on social media and getting into dialogues. I would prefer if people would contact me via email or phone, and I would gladly answer your questions on a personal level, and I would gladly have a conversation with any of you, including you, Rick. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mary Beth. George? Sorry, actually, I skipped stuff.
I just wanted to let everyone know that Teachers Treasures will be open tomorrow, and it will be open every first and third Wednesday. And it opens at 6, and it's open until 7:30, and it's still located at the same place in Mossside Middle School. We are accepting donations from our teachers who have very generously donated in the past, and also community members. If you have any gently used clothing that you would like to donate, please donate at the front office at Mossside Middle School. Also, I'd like to remind everyone to please come to our curriculum meeting on Thursday, March 17th at 6 o'clock at the district administration office. I'd also like to say I appreciate everyone taking the time to come out to the meeting on March 4th, and I am sorry that we're not able to answer all of your questions, but I can assure you over time that we will. I'd like to congratulate Monet Findley for her submission to join together to Say No More, an awareness of dating violence. Also, congratulations to the 45 inductees of the National Honor Society. That's amazing, because you're doing a great job. And finally, I am looking forward to the production of On the Town.
Thank you, sir. George?
Yeah, I just got a few things to say. I was elected on this board to help the children and the taxpayers of Monroeville and Pitcairn. I never was and never will be a politician. So if you ever want to reach me, you'll get an honest answer. No backdoor politics with me. You could reach me at George G. Lapsovich, Gateway, K-12.org. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Val?
Yes, I just want to say good luck to the Sea Perch team. Congratulations. Doing a great job. Also, the performance with the play, it's going to be awesome, as it always is, Mr. Reed puts on. And the congratulations to the National Honor Society. Some of us have tried to make the evening affairs, but due to work schedules, we're not able to always attend. So please, a little lenient on that. And other things, everything seems to be running well at all the elementaries and middle schools that I have seen going through on my spare time. And I just want to wish all the spring sports good luck as it starts up this year, as it starts up now. That's it.
Thank you, Valerie. Steve?
A couple of comments I'd like to make. First of all, congratulations to the robotics team. That was a tremendous demonstration of the kind of expertise and ability that our young folks are acquiring here in the district, and that will certainly bode well for them long term. I also want to congratulate the 45 kids that made the National Honor Society. That's a tremendous achievement, and the parents and the young folks that do that should be extraordinarily proud. It's a little bit sad to hear John's report, the meeting of the legislators who, if I'm recalling what you said correctly, now understand that they have to compromise in Harrisburg. That's 259 days that it took them to figure that out. That's pretty sad. We vote these legislators in, we pay them, and we expect them to do a job. And they haven't done that job. And they put that burden back on school districts and on residents. So I think each and every one of us ought to keep in mind as we go forward that the people we elect apparently have not yet figured out that they have to compromise. This democratic society is founded on compromise. And I guess we're looking at the underside of a year before they can figure that out. I just think that's sad. And I think we ought to consider and remember that when we go to the polls in the primary. Mr. Atwood, I appreciate, Mr. Atwood, right? I appreciate you coming to the podium and speaking and raising your concerns. But I appreciate Ms. Roberts doing the same. There's no question that the email that went out was a mistake. Everybody's saying that. We all know that. Certainly wasn't done on purpose, but it was a mistake, and it was a bad mistake. And I also want everybody here and those viewing this to understand that this board does communicate regularly with one another, as Mary Beth commented, so that because there's not a meeting is not necessarily indicate that we aren't addressing or talking about how to address issues, because in fact, we are, and we do it regularly. My estimate is that maybe I made 150 or received 150 phone calls during that period of time, and that includes calls from all the board members and the administration and parents. So
I don't want you to think for a moment that we didn't understand that was a mistake, that we didn't do our best to address it. Might not have been a perfect set of solutions, but we worked at it every day. I think we also understand that part of addressing issues like that that arise is rooted in the extent to which we ensure that each and every child achieves here educationally to the best of their ability. Most of the folks here know that this board has formed a committee to address closing the achievement gap here in the district. And I think that's one very important major step forward in terms of addressing those kinds of issues. Secondly, I think the board understands that we need to find ways to better communicate the very positive things that occur here day in and day out, week in and week out, month in and month out. The very exceptional students we have here, the extent to which we celebrate diversity, the extent to which diversity adds materially to the quality of life in our community. But we have to find a way to tell that story more effectively. And I think to a large extent that falls on the shoulders of the of this board. And I have a lot of confidence in this board that it's going to deal with those kinds of things and deal with them effectively. You all understand that there's change afoot. Much of it, by the way, initiated informally through discussions with this board prior to the incidents that have occurred most recently. And I think you're going to see proof of that as we move through the end of the term and through the summer. And I think they're going to be particularly positive in nature, and hopefully the community will support the kinds of things that the board will bring forward. And finally, although many of the comments that were raised around the email, much of the vitriol was negative, was bad. Certainly things on email were, on Twitter and on Facebook were really bad, terrible sorts of things. But we as a community have to learn to rise above that. And so here was a takeaway that I want to share with you with respect to that meeting. I know there were a lot of criticisms of the board and the board's actions, some of them warranted, some of them not. But did you listen to the extent to which even people who criticized us did so in a civil manner? They came up, they expressed their point of view, they were angry, they were upset, legitimately angry, upset, but they did it the right way. And there were a lot of folks that came to that meeting that spoke well of the district and spoke to the achievements that the district was making. There was a woman who came and spoke about how much better she felt this district was than another one that she worked at. I don't know if you remember that or not. This is a community that is changing. There's no question about that. But the change is for the better. And we here at Gateway have to find ways to embrace that change, take on the challenges, and emphasize the very positive stuff that comes out of that. I've got a lot of confidence, again, as I said, that this board will be able to do that. As difficult as those meetings were, I heard good stuff there. I was impressed by the people who arise and speak their mind like you've done and what you have done. That's healthy. That's how we make progress. If we educate our students, our children effectively, they're going to be able to manage diversity, they're going to be able to manage criticisms, and they're going to be able to work their way through these kinds of issues and the ones that are going to challenge them down the road. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Steve. Neil?
Just a couple quick things, please. Please go to the play. It's always professionally done. It's awesome. It's just a great thing to see. Please encourage the kids. It's really, I've gone to a few neighboring schools' plays. I've known children in them. Not to be biased, but ours is better. So. All right. So we have a lot of good things happening here at Gateway. We have students excelling, as evidenced by stuff up here. We have teachers, administrators, the board, and the community. We're all the people who support and encourage the greatness from these students. It's important for all of us to realize that we all are playing a role in this. You know, all of us, we're all there. And I want to just say, and I know there's a lot of negative things going around here and there, and I'm willing to accept any heat that comes our way, but we all are responsible for our own actions, and we need to keep that in mind. A lot of times you need to look in the mirror sometimes, because it's hard to throw stones when you don't know everything. I don't know everything. I don't think anybody up here knows everything. I don't think anybody knows everything. I just think that it's a better time I think we have an opportunity right now. I can assure you that the board is working as hard as it can to make Gateway a great place. I know, because I listen, I hear them, I speak with them all way more than I really want to. No, I'm just kidding. No, I do speak with them all often, as I think Steve and Mary Beth both said, we speak often. So we are doing everything we can to make Gateway a great place. And I think that this is a time and an opportunity for all of us to rally more around each other, because I think that's what we need. I think that what we need is to come together. And I think that that's what happens most times when there is any type of conflict or any type of stress or anxiety put on anybody. It's a good time to step back, think about what's going on, check yourself, and then rally around each other. And that's everybody. That's administrators, that's teachers, that's the board, that's the community, it's every student, it's everybody. We're a great place. This is a great place. I've had three kids that went through this school. This is a great place. Let's just keep it that way.
Thank you, Neil. So a few issues to address, and I will try to stay brief. But first and foremost, I would like to, again, congratulate the National Honor Society recipients. So just those of you that are unaware, they have to hold a cumulative 3.7 the entire way through high school. That's quite an achievement. And for those 45 students that were awarded or given the honor of becoming members of the National Honor Society, congratulations. I'd also like to congratulate Mitch, Sam, Asher, and Luke with the Sea Perch. And I think we can definitely make sure that they're going down to LSU. I think that's a once-in-a-lifetime experience, and I would like to say congratulations again to them. Congratulations to Paul Schott on your contract being renewed. I look forward to working with you over the next 2 years. The musical, so April, and I will start this by saying I am very biased. I was in the musical when I attended Gateway, and their performances are way better than a lot of the other districts. So everything from the set that the parents volunteer and work tirelessly into producing, to the students coming in, day out, over the weekends. I mean, we have guys that have never danced before learning how to dance. And it's remarkable when everything comes together. So April 8th through the 10th, and then also on the 15th and 16th, please make sure you buy your tickets and attend the musical. And they do, most days usually do sell out. So definitely make sure you do that. April 23rd, we had a brief presentation by one of the students two weeks ago in regards to Mini-Thon. So Gateway High School students have taken it upon themselves to introduce a Mini-Thon similar to what PSU does, Penn State does, for their Thon event. So I believe it's from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Might have the times a little bit wrong, but there are and we'll definitely get the information out to the public. There's different times where there's different events for community members. I definitely would encourage you to come in. Our students do a lot of great events. They do a lot of great fundraisers, literally raise tens of thousands of dollars. We saw pennies, right? They collected $1,500 in pennies. So they're doing remarkable things. Budget meeting, Wednesday, March 30th. please come out to that. Also, this Thursday, March 17th, we have a curriculum meeting. And Rabbi Barbie would ask what subjects. I did look into that for you. It is math, grades 5, 6, 7, and 8, world language, 7 through 12, and phys ed, 9 through 12. 10 a.m. to 8 p.m., I was right, for the mini-thon. So. I also want to say, and no one said it yet, but I think we all feel this way, kudos to all the kids at the high school through this whole ordeal. I think had parents not gotten involved, I think they handled themselves well. They took care of a lot of the issues, and they did a great job. So apologies that parents got involved. Apologies that an email went out and caused some very hateful, very racist comments to appear on our Facebook page, which is why I had asked that those come down. Few messages from a few parents in this district is not representative of what this district is. So anytime I see messages like that, I will ask that they are taken down. For the simple fact that that's not the message that these students are spewing. This isn't the message that the majority of parents in this room are spewing. So for the few that did have hateful messages, well, shame on you. I also like to congratulate my brother. He's a teacher down in Florida. He's a 2004 Gateway graduate. He was just honored on national TV for a Teacher of the Week. So I just wanted to send a shout out there. And lastly, I just wish that everyone have a blessed Easter. And that is all. Do we have a motion for adjournment?
Moved. Second.
Motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, motion or meeting is adjourned.